to Friday Night Fan Fights, coming at you live here on twitch.tv/Invicta. Also on the VODs at youtube.com/Invicta316. Go to my YouTube channel for all of the VODs. Well, most of the VODs of Friday Night Fan Fights, along with my other weekly programming like Saturday, a series SmackDown, which is of course happening tomorrow, and also the ever-popular Try Hard Thursday. Yes, indeed. We are all ready and set to go for game number one of the first best of three of Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. But before I get to that, a couple of really fast announcements. If you would like a chance to play in the Friday Night Fan Fights tonight, you can join the North American group chat, Sinvicta. That is where I'm going to be taking people from. Invites do go to sub priority, and then the other games will be non-sub. And by other games, I mean the final best of three. But we don't have a lot of people in chat right now. Again, usually the formula for Friday Night Fan Fights is everyone kind of doesn't remember that the show is going on except for the regular followers to the stream or the subscribers here on Twitch. And then by the second best of three, everyone's like, oh my gosh, there's something going on. And then by the third best of three, everybody piles into the chat when I've already had like the opponent selected ready to go. So yeah, this is a good lesson for everyone out there. If you are interested in playing, you need to get here on time, even though we didn't start on time technically at the time of this recording because I had such an amazing FTL run going. Also, really fast, I have decided to postpone the 24-hour stream that was supposed to be taking place tomorrow, which would be the 20th of September. I have postponed it till next Saturday, which is going to be the 27th of September. I still am suffering from a pretty nasty sore throat, which flared up last night during Try Hard Thursday, and it would not be wise for me to blow out my vocal cords because this is my job. It's what I have to do. So yeah, I am going to be doing a 24-hour stream next Saturday, not tomorrow. And again, I will be making a separate video for everyone on YouTube as well as Twitter and Facebook and stuff to let them know in case if they are planning. I will cut that out as soon as possible and get it uploaded. But enough about that. Let's hop into game number one of the first best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. Let me make sure that the combatants are ready to go. And as soon as they give me the okay, they will they'll let me know. Looks like they are ready to go, and we are underway. So here we are, spawning on Acalon Wastes, one of my favorite maps of all time. Introducing the players right now, spawning on the northwestern side, playing as the Blue Protoss. He's a member of the Mosh Pit here on Twitch. He's a Bronze Leaguer, and he goes by the name of Aziraku. And spawning on the southeastern side of Acalon Waste, playing as random, spawning as Terran. Playing as a red Terran, he's a Silver Leaguer. He goes by the name of Halo Staru. So it's going to be a TVP to open up tonight's Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. And again, if you are interested in playing, or at least getting a chance to play, you can join the North American group chat, Sinvicta. And as a reminder to anyone out there who is watching on this live who is a member of the Mosh Pit, we literally only had one member showing up in the special subscribers-only chat room. So make sure you're checking your Twitch TV PM boxes because it contains good information for you subs out there. Just FYI. As we're going to have Aziraku scouting out here, very, very early gas coming out from a Halo Star. And Halo Star is playing as random, so I do not know his skill level in regards to Terran. All I know is he's a Silver Leaguer taking on a Bronze Leaguer. Aziraku going to be opening up with a gateway on the high ground, blocking off the ramp. Not something you traditionally see in a TVP. And the reason why I say that is because it's very, very easy for Terran to scan up there and either have some siege tanks below ground, or they'll just blow the heck out of the building with a bunch of Marauders and Marines. Yeah, normally, if in a TVP, if you know it, or if you think you're going to take an even not so early expansion, you'd usually see the SimCity going down right at the top of the ramp of the natural expansion and not walling off. But we are talking about the very classic and cute and cuddly Bronze League and Silver League, so we're not expecting any sort of top tier shape control. And we are going to see first blood grabbed by that SCV. A probe goes down. Aziraku not paying attention and loses it. He's going to go Cybernetics Core, powered off of one pylon. Again, usually that's kind of considered a little reckless, but that's okay. We're not going to hurt him for it. We're not going to harm him for it. And we're certainly not going to make fun of him for it. Meanwhile, Halo Star thinking about doing something. Is he going to proxy his own natural? He's looking for possibly an even proxiered building. Coming out from Ozzy Rocker, of course. We know that there's no building, but, of course, Halo Star does not know that. Second rack's coming down here for Halo Star as we get underway with game number one of the first best of three on Friday Night Fan Fights. Number 42. Second pylon at the top of the ramp. Very nice job indeed by Ozzy, thereby making sure that if this pylon goes down, this one will too, because it's right at the top of the ramp and fully exposed. Double gas now coming from Ozzy Rocker, and he is going to go for a Twilight Council, so is this going to be DTs? It may very well be DTs. We'll have to wait and find out. Still only one gas for Halo Star, and we're waiting for the all-important next building. Whatever building comes up here on the production tab will be pretty much giving away what Ozzy is planning on doing. There you go. So Ozzy Rocker able to take one more down. He does have warp gates. Warp gate research nearly complete. Now, what is he going to build? Is it going to be a dark shrine? It is going to be a dark shrine. So look at that. The 5.5 minute mark, dark shrine. And will Halo Star be ready for this? I'm not quite sure. He's playing the correct race. I mean, he's playing as Terran. And if you need some stealth detectors, come standard on every command center as soon as you make it into an orbital command. Now, the only bad thing about the placement of this Dark Shrine is that if Halo Star decides to throw down a scan instead of throwing down a mule, he could very well be taken by surprise on this. Dark Shrine halfway done for Ozzy Rocker in the opening segments, the opening bits of the first best of three. This PVT is going to be bronze versus silver. Halo Star playing as random. He is going to be supply blocked. That's what the four supply depots at the same time are coming out for. That Dark Shrine nearly complete, and we will have to find out exactly where Ozzy's going to be dropping these DTs. Now, I should point out that Ozzy has not thrown out a preemptive proxy pylon, which is what he's going to do right now. But unfortunately, the timing is a little bit off because the Dark Shrine is nearly done, and by the time this probe gets to wherever the heck he's going, which is going to be right there, the DTs could have already been out on the field. Natural expansion underway, and Ozzy Rocker even preemptively building the double assimilators there. Yeah, most of the time you would usually want that on your pro production or tech, anything like that. The only time I would ever suggest preemptively building assimilators or any Vespian Geyser buildings is when you're timing your drone transfer, probe transfer, or SCV transfer there. Again, not that big of a deal. So here we go. This is going to be Ozzy. He's got the pylon up. He's got the funds. Where are the DTs? DTs, well, they're thinking about coming out. Army supply in favor of Halo Star. Now, he does not have enough for a scan, and Halo Star has also not gone for a natural expansion, and the DTs, well, they got there eventually. They decided to hoof it from home. They weren't going to be, they weren't going to take the shortcut. They need to get their leg day, and never skip leg day. So four DTs in total for Ozzy Rocker, and we have to keep an eye on the scanning, on the energy here for the sweep. It's going to be lining up pretty nicely. Ozzy Rocker's got to do a lot of damage here. In 2 seconds, he's not going to be able to have the element of surprise. He is going to back off. That supply depot is not flaming, so it will not burn down. But now the nice thing about what Ozzy has done is he's effectively sealed off and contained anything Halo Star does. Oh, but look at this. The trap has been set. He let the front door close, or open, I should say, and the DTs took the bait. Now, Ozzy does not know this, but that was the only scan that Halo Star has. And if Ozzy Rocker decides to press this and finds out that there is no other energy for the orbital command, this could be bad news for Halo Star. There's no missile turrets to speak of. I don't even know if there's no engineering bay either. It's only just now halfway done. Oh, Ozzy, if you just try it one more time, the next scan will be available in about 10 seconds, and Ozzy Rocker, unfortunately, got a little too scared after that first one, and there's the second scan. So a little bit of a missed opportunity for Ozzy. Oh, don't send the DTs up there, Ozzy. Don't do it. Don't do it. It was a TARP the first time. Even the missile turret now going down. Enough time has passed for the engineering bay to complete. And these DTs will not be able to do anything. They had a golden window of opportunity there, And of course, we know it best. We know exactly the energy situation. And I'm not faulting Ozzy for that, but I feel he could have definitely taken another poke just to see if there was any more scans. But now with this missile turret, yeah, that is going to get shut down very quickly. But Ozzy's still going to try to harass his expansion. He is able to force a liftoff. And again, keep in mind there's only going to be one scan available right now. So this little contain with the DTs for Ozzy is actually working fairly well. But just imagine if he would have actually sent those through the front door of the main base of Halo All-Star. Or Halo Star. I don't know why I keep calling them All-Star. Maybe it's because they have the word all in the clan tag there. Dyslexia and whatnot. Armored supply tab going to be heavily in favor of Halo Star, but he cannot move right now, although he does have a Raven, and a very, very early Raven, and that will most certainly end the DT harassment. The DTs are spotted by the Raven, and basically now what Halo Star is doing is he's tempting the DTs to come. He says, come at me, bro. Oh, the siege tank is unsieged, though. And Halo Star's got to be careful with the siege tank. It could get picked off if they're not careful. The DTs see see their coming doom and decide to back off. So Ozzy Rocker has quietly gotten a little bit of a gateway army, but that is going to get completely destroyed by this Bioforce. And Halo Star has successfully broken the siege on his natural expansion. And we're going to be going into the mid game here. So now at this point, what can Ozzy really do? Well, he's doing one of the two things I was going to say, which of course is going to be making those Archons from the Dark Templar, since the Dark Templar are basically useless now. And I would suggest also throwing down a Twilight Council, or I'm sorry, a Templar Archives for High Templars, because he does know he's going up against a very, very bio-heavy force. And Psy Storms are good. He can even take himself a third base, knock down these rocks, bring down the rock tower, and then establish his third base. So we'll have to wait and see if Ozzy is going to throw down a Twilight or a Templar Archives or not. Why is he throwing out photon cannons? It's probably something that should have happened a little bit earlier, but that's okay. So Halo Star, a little bit apprehensive about leaving, and the funny thing is, Halo Star didn't even see the Gateway Army. Well, I guess he does see it now. He knows where the army is, thanks to that scan. So now he's going to feel a little bit braver about leaving. He can leave the base if he wants to. He can leave the base behind, because if your army doesn't base, your friends don't base, then there are no base of mine. Halo Star is saying, well, in case of any medevacs come from the western portion of, they will be shot down immediately, eventually, by three turrets. Lord knows that 150 minerals for the extra two missile turrets could have been used in, oh, I don't know, engineering bay upgrades, that sort of thing. That's all right. Not going to talk about it. More zealots now warping in, and Ozzy Rocker is going to be throwing down that Templar Archives along with a Colossus. But again, Psy Storm would be huge, huge, huge. It would be absolute amazeballs in this next fight, whenever that happens. And Halo Stars needs to be careful. He's getting a little bit too cocky. And he doesn't even lead the army supply anymore. He knows that there's Archons out on the field. Why Ozzy Rocker is not... oh, he has taken this out. Why did the probe go that way? He must have sent the probe out there before taking out the rocks. It's the only thing I can think of. Either that or that is the most daft probe in the entire world. The Sinvicta probe. But the unit composition for Halo Star is not that great, comparatively speaking, to Ozzy's. So the rock tower will come down. Stimpak already used way behind where they should have been used. And this is not going to go well for Halo Star. He needs to back up right now. Even with one Colossus, that does plus one attack. These Bioforce for Halo Star are not upgraded. And that's only three siege tanks, and that sounds like a lot, but it's really not, especially if they're going to be firing on the Archons. Here we go again. Look how quickly the Bioforce dies. They do not have plus one armor. Archons tanking most of the shots. This is exactly what I was talking about. Splash damage taking out everything, and Ozzy Rocker, well, he move commanded a little bit there. He lost a couple other gateway units, but he will eventually be able to absolutely mollywop the Force of Halo Star. Everything 100% total loss. Ozzy Rocker also still has the proxy pylon, which has not been found by Halo Star. And now, even what's crazy about this is that having that DT shrine is going to be even more problematic than Psystorm is, because not only is Halo Star not expecting the resurgence of DTs, he's also going to have to be worrying about micromanaging vision, and that's normally out of the range of the lower level skill set. And again, that is no slight to either of these two players. I'm just telling it how it is. It is very difficult to worry about not only not dying, but also knowing that, hey, I need detection, I need scans. I lost all my Ravens, and Halo Star may just end up dropping this on game number one, and there you go. So down goes the natural expansion. Halo Star, I don't know how much he's played Terran, but unfortunately, the random roll did not work out. Again, he was playing random, and he spawned as Terran. He definitely has some early advantages, especially catching those DTs, but Ozzy Rocker able to push it back, and it does look like we should be seeing the GG. GG, game one goes to Ozzy Rocker, the Bronze Leaguer, taking out the Silver Leaguer. So, nice job there by Ozzy, taking game number one over Halo Star. And again, if you're interested in trying to get a chance to get an invite tonight for Friday Night Fan Fights, you can join the North American Battle.net server group chat, Sinvicta. Remember, that's the group chat, not the chat room, but the group chat itself inside of the StarCraft II group. Very nicely done by Ozzy Rocker, taking game number one. It's best of three. And again, if you are interested in playing tonight, all you got to do is join that group chat. Try to get you in. We'll be doing three best of threes tonight. As a quick reminder, that the 24-hour stream tomorrow is going to be postponed by 1 week to give my voice a rest. You may hear a little bit of scratchiness in the voice tonight. Everything was fine. I was healing just perfect, and then last night's Try Hard Thursday happened, and that was all she wrote. So we only have eight people in the chat right now. Like I said, this is how the standard Friday Night Fan Fights go. Everyone doesn't realize that the show is going on until the second best of three starts. And then they're like, oh man, I got to get in for the show. This is awesome. And by the time everyone gets there, we just get a surge of people collectiving inside of the Sinvicta group chat. And then by that time, the best of three has already begun and everyone gets mad. Oh, Sinvicta prioritizes Zerpa Derpa. And it's like, well, yeah, I prioritize people who are in the chat at the time for invites. And yeah, you have a good chance of actually playing tonight, I promise you. So waiting for both players to load, and when they do, we shall begin game number two of Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. There we go, the game is loaded. The players are ready to go. And here we are. Game number two spawning on Cloud Kingdom. Playing as the blue Protoss. Currently up one game to nothing. He's a Bronze Leaguer, member of the Mosh Pit. He goes by the name of Ozzy Rocker. And spawning on the southwestern side of Cloud Kingdom. Playing as the Red Zerg. Playing his random spawn to Zerg. He's a Silver Leaguer. Can he bring it back and force the rubber match? He goes by the name of Halo Star. So Halo Star already throwing down the 10 pool. He wants to end this game early and send it to a best of three. So Ozzy Rocker. And Ozzy does know he's going up against a random, and he's going to instinctively wall off. And I should say this is, and I apologize to, I actually apologize to Ozzy for the last game. I had forgotten that Ozzy had not known the race declaration at the random roll at the beginning of the game, which is why he instinctively walled off. I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt. I haven't talked to Ozzy, but I know he's going to go back through the VODs and watch it and say, well, there's a reason why I walled off is because I didn't know what race I was playing, and that is 100% correct. You should instinctively wall off, because if you are playing someone who is playing as random on the ladder or even not on the ladder, you can't take chances. So I rescind my PVT strategy there at the beginning of game number one. Again, I did not think about the fact that Ozzy Rocker possibly did not know what race he was going up against, since Halo Star is playing as random. And I take that back. I'm giving Ozzy the benefit of the doubt. Unfortunately, right now, Halo Star is going to get a very nasty supply block, which has still not been cleared. I always want to make sure if you are playing as Zerg, dropping down that Overlord on the 9 supply. And then by the time the 10th drone rolls around, your Overlord is set and ready to go, and he's saying... So did Ozzy Rocker see the pool? He did see the pool. And the two Lings are on their way. I don't know if Ozzy was planning on going for a... No, he wasn't planning on going for anything, really. That probe shaking in its boots. Or at least shaking in its bike stands. Not get spotted by the Zerglingus. And Ozzy can, he does actually see the Zerglings, and I don't know if he's planning on canceling this pylon, but it was a nice job there blocking the natural expansion, because this strategy works two ways. This is twofold. Number one, he gets to at least delay the natural expansion. Number two, he's caused some of the Zerglings to not be present for this attack, thus buying himself enough time to get another Zealot, although he's not making another Zealot right now. Ozzy, what are you doing? The Zealot has fallen. The Zealot was not put on the hold command. Down he goes. Mothership Core has to be forced to be activated now. And will Ozzy lose any probes here? It doesn't look like he will, even though he probably should have. And Halo is completely fine. He's completely fine. All right. Halo Star now regrouping at the base of the natural expansion. Ozzy's really got to get that Zealot in the hold command. I don't even know. Even if he was on the hold position here, I don't think that is a Zergling tight wall off. A second Zealot is sorely needed. This Stalker is not going to do anything against these Lings. But again, talking about what I was talking about at the natural expansion, that with that pylon, it's debatable whether or not he should have let that finish. I personally would have let that finish. If I was Ozzy, because the Zerglings are forced, they're going to get distracted and they're forced to clear that, whereas canceling it, I mean, only saves you a couple seconds. Oh, Ozzy, don't take the bait, Ozzy. Don't take the bait. Ozzy is going to get trapped twice in a row. The trap has been set, and the Zerglingus are on the way. Stalkers desperately trying to maneuver their way back. Luckily, the Mothership Core is here, but Halo Star has enough, he has enough Lings to take this out. And the Zealot is going to get fully surrounded, possibly. The Mothership Core very, 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 very slowly taking out one Zergling at a time. But I think Ozzy is going to be fine in the end of things. A little bit of apprehensiveness coming out from Halo Star. He really could have done a lot of damage there. He could have easily killed the Stalkers and the Zealot. But the Mothership Core just too scary with her 6 kills. Metabolic Boost has finished, and Halo Star is going to transition into a two-base play, which is pretty much all he can do. I would prefer to see Halo Star pull off the drones at around 100 gas. Well, he's actually got more than 100 gas now. Here, this is a tip. If you go for a 10 pool, or this is a Synvicta strategy moment, strategery moment. If you decide to go for a 10 pool and does not work, you don't need gas anymore. What you need to do is drone behind this, because you will be behind. If you did not kill anything and you did not stop, you did not impede the natural expansion coming down, you need to catch up. It is your responsibility as a Zerg player to drone behind this. You don't need gas anytime soon, especially after you've already invested 100 in the metabolic boost. Throw down spine crawlers. You're going to need 3 at the natural expansion. Maybe a sport crawler if you're playing against Terran or something like that, but for the most part, you need to make sure you shore up those defenses and get caught back up, because now you're facing a two-basing Protoss who is not only going to be mining better than you at his natural expansion, but also is already has an army advantage and it had the economy advantage because he put more into his economy than you did thanks to your 10 pool. But again, Halo Star may or may not be a Zerg player, and he's, of course, Silver League. But I do try to point things out as best as I can. Halo Star now very, very undersaturated in the main. Even has one. Oh, that drone was stopped for a second there. Hydralisk again coming out. Now here's a here's another thing that I would say. Hopefully Halo Star is able to watch this on YouTube later on. One thing I would say is, the aforementioned, you want to be droning if your 10 pool did not work. Second thing I'll say is don't ever, ever, ever try a one-base Hydralisk play, even if you had two gases. The earliest you could ever transition to Hydras out of a 10 pool will be if you have four gases, and that is not happening anytime soon. So basically what Halo is going to do is he's going to find out that, hey, Hydralisk cost a lot of money and gas, and he's going to be able to make maybe two Hydralisk and then be flat broke for the rest of the game. But again, I don't know if Halo Star actually plays as Zerg. Again, he plays as random spawn as Zerg. But he really needs to get those drones kicked out of there. He is now droning up behind this, but his saturation is leaving a little bit to be desired on the main base. Now it's actually pretty much almost at perfect saturation. The problem is all this is happening too slow, and Aussie Rocker, if he gets an observer in the main base of Halo Star, even at the natural, he's going to see, hey, there's nothing here. I can literally A move and then walk away from the computer and win this game. Aussie Rocker now is suffering a little bit of a supply block. Not that big of a deal. It is a little bit risky to keep this pylon powering, especially the Cybernetics Core and also two gateways. Not that big of a deal in right now, but again, in hindsight, if this were to be taken out, that would be bad news for Aussie Rocker. Whether or not that's going to happen or not is, of course, left up to, well, the viewers who have the ability to fast forward in time, which I currently do not do right now. Very, very, very early lair transition into the Hydralisk. This is crippling the early game economy of Halo Star. That gas could sorely, sorely be used, or could easily be used for upgrades, especially getting upgrades out, but he really needs to get static defense. These Lings are not going to be able to hold this. Army supply tab, more than double supply in favor of Aussie Rocker. And, paltry force of, how many Zerglings is that? It's going to be 27 Zerglings and five Hydralisks. It's not going to work. Not going to work too well. I guess I could have just gone to the units tab, but hey, I know how to count. So Aussie Rocker is going to just go right up the gut here. He's not even waiting for plus one weapons. And these Stalkers are going to aggro the Lings, and here we go. Luckily, Halo Star pulling these back, but just imagine what this would look like if he had, like, three Spine Crawlers at the beginning. The Hydralisks are all the Zerglings are nearly dead. Hydralisks are still alive, but what are five Hydralisks going to do against this? So Halo Star is going to drop the natural expansion. So many larvae. And he's trying to make 24 Lings, but 24 Lings are not going to help out. Halo Star wisely pulling away the Hydralisks that just spawned. And Aussie Rocker is just going to move right into the main base. So the Lings have spawned, and this is going to be the last stand of Halo Star. He may be able to take out the Zealots here, but unless Aussie Rocker bungles the micro, this is going to be that. Hydralisks do tons of damage, but unfortunately it's not going to be enough. Zealots messing with the larva in the back. So Halo Star is going to GG. And congratulations to Aussie Rocker for closing out the series, beating the Silver Leaguer. And a shout out to Halo Star. Again, I don't know what races Halo Star is better at, but if he's willing to learn and try out Zerg, then hopefully I would have been able to give him a little bit A little bit of info, a little bit of tips there. When we come back, we'll begin game number one of the second best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just one moment. Set and ready to go for game number one of the second best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 42, coming at you live on Friday, September 19th, 2014. The players are loaded, the game has begun, and here we are spawning on Derelict Watcher TE, playing as the Purple Zerg. He's a Diamond Leaguer, member of the Mosh Pit. He goes by the name of Morgan Freeman, and spawning on the northwest or northeastern side of Derelict Watcher TE, playing as the Red Terran. He's also a Diamond Leaguer, and he goes by the name of Mr. Halloween. So we get a Diamond versus Diamond ZVT here to kick off game number one of the second best of three on Derelict Watcher. Not the best Zerg map, admittedly so, I will say. It's a very, very friendly map to Terran and Protoss, who decide to use that good old-fashioned special tactics drop play. But it's certainly not unwinnable. One of the big gripes that Zerg players have is the humongous main base plateau, which I have to agree with. I don't really complain much about StarCraft 2 as far as like the actual map design goes, because if you're on the ladder, you can just veto these. But at the time during when Derelict Watcher was made into a ladder map, there were plenty of other maps that you had to veto, and Derelict Watcher was normally not one of them. But if I did have to say one thing, I will say that this harkens back to last week's Friday Night Fan Fights. You always want to make sure that you don't have any dark space in your main base. We saw that. Who was it? It was, I don't remember. I think it was the first best of three last week, where we had somebody who completely did not scout out their main base. They got proxied. I think it was a proxy two racks in their main base on Newkirk, and it was certainly something. So Mr. Halloween going to be coming out with a standard opener Reaper for the 4-minute mark. Mr. Halloween pretty much only makes Reapers in the early stages of the game just to get a couple scouts off. He tests his luck with Micro and whatnot, but again, he is going up against another Diamond Leaguer, so maybe Morgan Freeman will be up to the task. So Mr. Halloween going to be dropping down to that natural expansion as soon as he hits 400 eventually. Eventually. Leave it. There you go. Mr. Halloween got it. Reaper already halfway across the map towards the natural expansion. So he is, of course, going to spot the natural expo. Queen timing a little bit behind for Morgan Freeman's natural expansion queen. You see the micro coming out on the drone to get that extractor up. Now that the Reaper is off creep, the Zerglings will not be able to keep up with the Reaper. And the assault on the drone continues. APMs, woo, burning up the keyboards. Someone get out the fire extinguisher. These players are hot, hot, hot. You may be saying, Sinvicta, how do you know his timing for the queen on the natural expansion is behind? Well, unless if he dropped down an early gas, which he did because he wants to get the early metabolic boost, the queen at the natural and at the main should always be out right as soon as the Reaper crosses this line. Even if he goes across this line and goes straight into your main base queen should already be done along with your natural expansion. Again, Morgan Freeman didn't lose any drones, so it's not that big of a deal. Like I said, with a little bit of basic micro, you can keep your drone alive Morgan Freeman did. Take it out. So Morgan Freeman going to be trying to bully the Reaper and escort the drone. I don't know if Mr. Halloween was noticing that drone or not. It doesn't look like he did, but there is going to be first blood. Down goes one Zergalingu, and the other Zergalingu will also be heading the way of the Dodo, an old Yeller. I don't believe Mr. Halloween saw that drone go up the ramp, however, and that could be a little bit of an issue coming up later on in the mid-game of this game, mid-stages of this game, I should say. So the Reaper right now just scouting out, trying to get a clear line for the Hellions, which are now going to be headed to the natural expansion here in game number one of the second best of three on Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. The Sore Throat Edition. Armor Supply going to be kind of in favor of Mr. Halloween, thanks to the other two Hellions that just spawned. And yeah, and look at this. Mr. Halloween's even going to miss the he's going to miss the Overlord, which is going to be scouting to see if that third base had been spotted by the Terran player. Of course, we know that it has not been. So this Overlord will eventually go down. He does see the lack of gas on the natural expansion. And these three queens, well, if Mr. Halloween didn't know about it now, he certainly did see those drones. Or he may not have seen those drones. He may have been messing with the Overlord and did not see the... It would have been very, very brief. But those drones definitely crossed the point of view of... or the line of sight, I should say, of those Hellions. So right now, Mr. Halloween only thinks that he's going up against a two-basing Zerg, which, of course, we know is not the case. And of course, if you're the Zerg player in this situation, you want to be ready for anything, pretty much. You know that he's got Hellions out on the field. You know he's got a Reaper, and you know that you have to assume that he's seen your base. You just have to. Never ever assume, and this really goes for any race in StarCraft or StarCraft II. Never assume anything about your opponent's vision. You cannot safely assume that. Okay, well, I can just assume that he hasn't seen this base yet. Even if you have a ninja expansion, don't ever rely on the assumption of thinking that your opponent has not seen something or has seen something, depending on the situation. You always want to prepare for, he probably knows about this, I need to get defenses, I know that three queens are not going to be enough to stop these Hellions. And right now you do see Morgan Freeman there using a transfuse, two transfuses, and still these queens are not safe. All the energy going into the transfuses, they are able to shoo the Hellions off, but if push came to shove with the basic micro, Mr. Halloween could have easily killed these three queens with just this handful of Hellions. He just micro the wounded Hellions to the back of the line. But there's going to be no such thing. It's going to be no microing. It's going to be no pushing out or anything like that. So if we go to the Morgan Freeman cam, you see, look at the minimap. He's got beautiful vision all over most of the map, except for where it really matters, which is going to be in the middle of the map. As a Zerg player, you may be saying, Sinvicta, where's the safest, best place for me to put an Overlord on the map like this in the middle? I'd say right here. There's no way the only thing that can kill this Overlord, there are exactly two units in the game that the Terran Dominion that would be able to kill an Overlord that's sitting right here in the middle. That would be the Viking and the Battlecruiser. Marines can't see it unless it's scanned. Missile turrets, I guess, but that doesn't count as a unit. Morgan Freeman already has the speed upgrade on his overlords. He actually got that upgrade a while ago. Spire nearly complete along with the Banalingu nest. Fourth base coming down here as well from Morgan Freeman. Definitely cannot falter for that. Even has a macro hatchery. Morgan Freeman on fire with his economy. Taking a look at the harvester tab, 66-61. Mr. Halloween actually doing a pretty good job keeping pace with our Zerg player. And that's either a result of our Zerg player not macroing hard enough or the simple fact that Mr. Halloween has way too many SEVs, which of course is going to be the latter. And again, we're not expecting pro-level plays or timing anything like that, even though they're Diamond Leaguers. There's always room for improvement, even if Master League or, Grandmaster, that sort of thing. And again, I do try to help out everyone that I can, regardless of what league that they're in, outside of Grandmaster or Master League, because I just don't know better. So the Mutalisks have to do a lot of damage to be worth it, and right now they didn't really cause a whole lot. I mean, seven SEVs sounds like a pretty good haul, but when you take into account, well, that's going to be eight Mutalisks. Those eight Mutalisks, in order for those to be cost effective, would have had to kill 16 SEVs just to break even on resources. Which again, this is something that Sinvicta says every single time I bring up the Mutalisk unit. I hate Mutalisks. Why? Because you need to have so much value to make them not even profitable, just break even. And against Terran, unless you have a huge flock of Mutalisks and you're just going for early Mutalisks, I just don't like it. I don't like it. I think honestly, Roach Hydra does pretty well against Terran if it's just pure bio, which right now it's got a smattering of a couple Widow Mines and a couple of the Hellions that did survive. But for the most part, Roaches and Hydras would absolutely steamroll all of this, even if the Widow Mines got perfect shots. But in the end, it comes down to what kind of style you like. I personally just don't like to play Mutalisks. Ever. Ever. In any situation, I never build Mutalisks. So the Mutas are going to be able to pick off a medevac here. They got a little too overzealous, and these Mutas will fly away. Do these Mutas have the... No, they do not. Whoa! Morgan Freeman! One Mutalisk did not get the memo. That GPS has not been updated. That Muta said, "Siri, take me home." And she was like, "Home. Turn around, go right." Because that's what Siri sounds like, of course, in StarCraft II. That Mutalisk was like, "Okay," and got blown straight to hell. Army supply tab in favor of Morgan Freeman. And 15 minutes has gone by and nothing has happened. Which is alright, both players macroing up. 33 Banalingus have been made and not used for anything. They will be soon. 1-1 on the bio upgrades is Mutalisk. Whoa! Will get shot down. And oh, I fear for Mr. Halloween. Here comes the wraparound with the Lings, the Banelings. There are Widow Mines, however, in play, and the Widow Mines have detonated on most of the Zerglings. The Banelings are still rolling around, however, and they will be able to kill off every single unit. That could have been such a better trade if Morgan Freeman had a little bit of detection, but it didn't matter in the end. So many units just died for Mr. Halloween. However, again, take a look at the overall resources lost. The Zerg has lost way more than the Terran player. And I don't want to say it's because of Mutalisks, but it might be because of Mutalisks and Banelings. Cost efficiency is key. Oh, the SCVs get completely steamrolled. They zigged when they should have zagged. Well, if they were looking for value from those Banelings, they just now got it. So many SCVs just died trying to run away from the third base. Why Mr. Halloween told them to run adjacent to the Banelings and Zerglings, I'm not quite sure. But he does not have to worry about losing any more SCVs at this base anytime soon. So Morgan Freeman still rocking and rolling, technically only on three bases. And the first skirmish is going to be won. First battle, I should say, is going to be won by Morgan Freeman. This war is not over by any means. Mr. Halloween losing so many harvesters. Trying to macro those back up. But look at this, we have Chitinous Plating on the way. And when the Ultras arrive, that's going to be bad news for Mr. Halloween. He does not have an Ultralisk killing force right now. He's got a Baneling. He's got a Ling Bling Muta killing force, but if you get even a couple of Ultralisks barreling down the front here, absorbing the Widowmine shots, it's going to be bad news. But here we go again. Morgan Frem is just going to go right for it. He needs to be careful with the move command. He's going to lose a couple of Mutalisks. He did get one shot off thanks to the Widowmine. That Widowmine didn't actually kill anything, however. And that's got to be because of the Carapace upgrade. Yeah, 2-2. I was going to say, that should have killed at least something. And Mr. Halloween trying to push back the containment here that Morgan Freeman has. Morgan Freeman even dropping down a fifth base, which is kind of debatable whether he needed a fifth base right now or not. I'd much prefer to see him get his fourth base saturated before trying to get for a fifth. Don't want to really spread your economy too thin. But again, we're not looking at pro players. I always just try to make sure I point out things that I notice. It's my job as a caster. I laughably call this a job. And here we go again. The Zerglings on the move command are going to start taking down the first couple of waves of Marines. And the back Widowmines actually do more friendly fire damage than anything else. Oh, the forward Widowmine play. They are going to get cleaned up by the Banelings and the Zerglings. But, man, oh, man, last very, very nice shot there at the very end. A huge shot by that Widowmine. But that could have gone so much better for Mr. Halloween. So the second battle goes to Morgan Freeman, but now is when it really starts getting tough for Mr. Halloween, who's trailing the Zerg. He's a three-base Terran versus a five. He's actually a two-and-a-half-base Terran versus a five-basing Zerg, technically a four-base, if you look at the saturation. But the Ultralisks have arrived. Seven Ultralisks on the way right now, and they are going to have 3-3. Those Ultras are actually going to be 3-5 thanks to Chitinous Plating. So the 2-2 of the Bio Army and the 0 attack upgrade on the... Well, I guess you can't really technically upgrade those Widow Mines, but it just does not matter. And more, Mr. Halloween's got to be a little bit careful with the scans on the Creep Tumor. You may be saying, well, that's kind of a dumb thing. Why would you ever say that, Sinvicta? Well, because the Widow Mines will actually aggro onto an exposed Creep Tumor that's planting down. It does count as a unit. Actually a really nice detonation there. A whole lot of Lings just died, but the Ultralisks have arrived, and they are hungry. Nom-nomming their way through the Bioforce. All Ultras are still alive, and Mr. Halloween will not be able to stop these Ultras from barreling down his front door. No more Widowmine, save for just one at the base of his natural expansion. And this is going to be a big old ouch time for Mr. Halloween if Morgan Freeman decides to go. Now, thankfully for Mr. Halloween, he does have 3-3. He will have 3-3 before this next engagement happens. And it looks like Morgan Freeman is just going to wait for... I guess he's just going to go... He's just going to wait for more Ultras. He could easily aim move into the main base and kill everything that Mr. Halloween has. Of course, we know that. Morgan Freeman does not. And that's just a little bit of lack of scouting coming in from Morgan Freeman. You see the only vision that he has now, thanks to the aggressive scouting denial of Mr. Halloween. Morgan Freeman can only see these supply depots. That doesn't tell him much. What he needs to do is, if he cared enough about it, is get a couple of changelings into this next battle and see what's going on in the main base. Now, Mr. Halloween going to be distracted a little bit. There is going to be the Planetary Fortress. And that Marine, that's not how physics work, unless there's like one of those dive boats where you can, like the glass bottom boats, you know? Pretty sure that they're not supposed to bounce off of anything right there. I'll have to alert Blizzard about that. So it's two battles to none here on the winds. Here we go again. The Widowmine. Well, there is no more Widowmine, and the Banelings and Ultralisks barreling down on the Bioforce here. Two Ultras don't even feel like doing anything, and they don't have to. These are 3-5 Ultralisks. They're officially Sinvictalisks at this point. And these Widowmines are just going to detonate on a whole lot of nothing. Able to take out a couple of the Mutalisks, but what does that care when you've got this many Ultras running down the front door of the Terran player? 10 Ultralisks still up alive and kicking and chomping and nomming and everything else. So Mr. Halloween's going to lose the natural expansion, He's going to have to try. He really is going to have to exploit the dumb AI of the Ultras at this point at the top of his ramp. He would be able to hold this if the Ultras filed in one at a time, but without any medevacs, I don't think it's going to matter. Mr. Halloween loses the natural. He doesn't really have anything left for the defense. Look how long it's taking these 3-3 Marines and 3-3 Marauders to kill this Ultra. That Ultra is still going, finally getting killed. And Morgan Freeman now realizes there is a third base here on the Eastern Expansion, and I can only imagine that Mr. Halloween will not be able to stop this base from going down. Look at that. Stimpak Marines do nothing. We even have a couple of Queens that are buried up here. And there's the GG, Morgan Freeman, finally taking the win in a war of attrition between two diamond players and layers, too. Yeah, they're layers. Might as well be layers. Nicely done by Morgan Freeman. And Mr. Halloween sure did put up a fight, but unfortunately he just fell too far behind on the economy and did not go his way. Game one will go to Morgan Freeman. Let's get ready for game number two in the second best of three. Most likely this will be the final best of three, by the way, as I've had something extremely important come up in the last 10 minutes. But we will finish off this best of three here before we call out the end of the show. So both players are in the game. They are ready to go. Again, as a quick reminder that tomorrow's 24-hour stream will be postponed till next week. Next Saturday, to be precise. That will be happening on Saturday, the September 27th, 2014, starting at noon Central, 1 p.m. Eastern, and 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. That's going to be next Saturday. It was going to be tomorrow, but again, I have postponed it just to kind of give my voice a little bit of a breather. I don't really want to overdo it. Last night's Try Hard Thursday was epic, of course, as most of the Try Hard Thursdays are. And the players are loaded up. The game has begun for game number two here on Friday Night Fan Fights. Number 42 spawning on King Sejong, Jadong Vu, Dijon Mustard, Jadong Toys R Us Station, playing as the Red Terran. He's a Diamond Leaguer, currently trailing 1-0. Can he force a rubber match to force a game three? Goes by the name of Mr. Halloween. And spawning on the southeastern side of King Sejong, Deja Vu, Dijon Mustard, Jadong Station, playing as the Purple Zerg. Also a Diamond Leaguer. He's up 1-0. Can he close out the series? In the name of the Swarm. He goes by the name of Morgan Freeman. So we'll have to see if there's going to be any deviation coming out from Mr. Halloween and Morgan Freeman. Again, this is most likely going to be the final. Actually, I will say this is the final best of three tonight, but don't you worry. Don't you worry. Got a lot more good things to come. It looks like it is going to be just a standard Mr. Halloween opener here with the Reaper. As Morgan Freeman taking the early natural. Nothing early about that. No, there's no boss fight tonight. I just said something. We got off. It's my fault. I mean, we got off to about 25-minute delay thanks to FTL, an amazing FTL run going on right now. But something has come up in the last 10 minutes that I have to take care of. So apologies. For those of you wanting to see the end of that FTL run, I will do that later on tonight on the stream. It's not going to be immediately following Friday Night Fan Fights, however. But I will also post that up on YouTube because I know a lot of people wanted to see the end of that stream. So it does look like Morgan Freeman going to opt for the early metabolic boost once again, Mr. Halloween. Got that Reaper nearly complete. And is ready to go. Ready to rock. Ready to reap, as they say. I sent the screenshot to Lethalfrag, my favorite streamer of all time. And he predicted that the flagship will die in 32 seconds with our amazing FTL run that we've got going on right now. That might be the most powerful ship I have ever had in FTL. Reaper's going to arrive at the natural expansion. This drone is trying to get microed out. It is going to get out the extractor just in the nick of time. One more shot would have killed it. And now this Reaper, the micro battles have begun. And he's fine. He's going to be completely fine. Reaper did not get much done. He did force a cancellation on the extractor. And, I mean, if you want to count that as a economic advantage, if you think that six minerals is an economic advantage, I would say okay. I would argue that the Reaper cost more than six minerals, however. So technically right now, Mr. Halloween is still in a little bit of a value deficit. So the Reaper of Mr. Halloween now going up to the northeastern side of Morgan Freeman's main base. And he's going to be out for blood. Reaper is just going to get a scout. He is able to see that there is metabolic boost on the way, and this should tell him to drop a bunker, which he's already done. He needs to get some Marines, get some Hellions out, and he should be fine. Morgan Freeman opting to not go for four Lings instead of keeping the two, which is a little bit risky, but since he does have two Queens out, he will be okay. He will be okay outside of Mr. Halloween deciding to send in like three more Reapers. That would be a little bit problematic. Three Reapers can not take down a queen without dying, without losing one, unless you micro them correctly. But they can kill, they can kill a lot of Lings and a lot of drones very quickly. So that way, two Hellions now changing, now joining up with the Reaper here. The second game of the second and final best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 42. 42. Just think, in 10 episodes, that would have been that would be an official 1 year's worth of Friday Night Fan Fights. When was the first episode of Friday Night Fan Fights? I wish Sadat was here. Sadat is currently on. He's currently traveling to the university and head back to school. When was the very first episode of Friday Night Fan Fights? I'm sure someone in the live audience could look that up. I don't know if it's been close to a year. It may have been close to a year since we've done it. I honestly don't remember. Mr. Halloween now walling up his natural expansion, which is what you need to be doing if you see an early metabolic boost, obviously. Do need to be careful of the Baneling bust. That's going to be a grand total. Six Hellions. Six Hellions and one Reaper who's just getting a piggyback ride. These six Hellions could do a ton of damage, but thankfully for Morgan Freeman, he does have a spine crawler. And, oh, the Hellions give themselves away by attacking the creep tumor. However, they will be able to absolutely fricassee French fry all these Zerglings. Down they go. These Hellions are enough to kill these queens. And, again, I don't know if Mr. Halloween, he may be, I don't know if he's expecting more Lings or not, but six Hellions can easily kill three queens. And, I mean, yeah, you're probably going to lose a Hellion or two, but with proper micro, you could kill them without losing anything. Mr. Halloween now barely, he's just now realizing it, taking all the energy off the queens there, and those are not spent on creep tumors, those are not spent on larva injects. So that is definitely getting you value. I still feel that he could have easily taken this out. They only have energy for one more transfuse. That would have been it. Now, Mr. Halloween did force the relocation of the spine crawler to a position that's completely useless, to be quite honest. I mean, this spine crawler is going to be able to protect anything that crosses this path. But there's one, two, well, only two ways around that path. But what I'm trying to say is it's very easy to circumvent this one spine crawler. That's basically the gist of this whole speech. But hey, at least the spine crawler, he made an effort. He gets an A for effort. He wanted to make sure that everyone knew he was still there. He mattered. He may just be one spine crawler in this workaday world of ours, but he does still matter. I assume that spine crawlers are male, only because of the fact that they start off as drones, which are, I believe, confirmed male in the StarCraft universe. Of course, Blizzard would probably say something like they do not conform to a gender, which would also make sense. But if we go off of, I mean, if we go off of, here's, I'm going to get really sciencey and nerdy on you. If we go off of real-world applications for swarm-type type civilizations like ants, termites, etc., most of the time drones are male, and the only female is usually the queen in the hive. Not always true, depending on the species, but then again, I am a giant nerd. So the Overlord absorbs a shot from the Widow Mines and doesn't get taken out. Fun fact, the Overlord will not die from one Widowmine shot, even if it's not augmented with any armor. So 2-2 on the way for Morgan Freeman, and these bio forces, Mr. Halloween, trying to keep up. They do have 1-1, and 2-2 is going to be, well, he's only right now... He's currently getting the armor or the combat shield before the second armor for the Marines. Does he only have Mr. Halloween only has one engineering bay? No, he's got two. He just doesn't have the gas for the second armor upgrade yet. Mutalists now have arrived for Morgan Freeman, and they get immediately thrown off by the missile turrets. Now, Sinvicta is going to give you another. Yeah, this is another. It's time for another episode of Things You Can't Unsee by Sinvicta. I know that my live chat loves when I do this sort of thing. Like the sorority girls taking a picture at the bar. Like the Johnny Five crawling up the side of, I think it was Newkirk. I don't remember which map that was. It's time to show you another thing in the StarCraft universe that you can never unsee. Are you ready? Gonna ruin something for you. Don't be mad at me. All right. Did you know that missile turrets are piloted by a human inside? That would be a human sitting inside of a missile turret. Right there. I bet you didn't know that. Missile turrets are actually piloted by somebody. This has been another episode of Things You Can't Unsee or Unknow, thanks to Sinvicta. Armor supply tab, in favor of Mr. Halloween. And the unit comp is not as great as it was in game one for Morgan Freeman, but actually, Mr. Halloween's going to be moving out here, and I don't know if he should be getting out of... Well, He's going to be sacrificing a couple of Marines here. But this is kind of a ballsy move for Mr. Halloween to be moving out with this many Widow Mines. And again, something you do have to keep in mind is the splash damage of the friendly fire of Widow Mines. If you move them too far ahead of the Bio Force, you can actually deal more damage to yourself than the enemy. Apparently a lot of people knew about that, about missile turrets. Okay, fair enough. I'll have to find something else to ruin then. Baneling's now not really getting the best of detonations off. They are able to get a decent detonation there towards the end, and I don't know why are the Mutalists flying backwards. Morgan Freeman, all the Widow Mines have been expelled, and I think Morgan Freeman just now realized that, but it's too late. The reinforcements have arrived. These Mutalists have any upgrades on them? They got plus one attack. Doesn't really help all that much. But Mr. Halloween will take the, I guess, call it a victory for the Terran Dominion right now, at least in that first battle. The war, of course, is not over by a long shot. Morgan Freeman just making sure that those two missile turrets that he saw at the very beginning of this game are still there, and indeed they are, with the humans in the piloting seat of the missile turrets. Armor supplies tab still in favor of Mr. Halloween. And oh, this could be bad for Morgan Freeman. That's so many Widow Mines. And the Widow Mines there take out every single Ling that was in the middle of those Marines. But now they have to deal with the Banelings. Here we go again. A huge detonation by the Widow Mines on the Mutalisks. All the Widow Mine shots have been expelled, but there's still another. There's three more Widow Mines sitting in the back behind this firing squad of Marines. And that did not go Morgan Freeman's way at all. The frailty, the frailness of the fragileness, the fragiliness of Zerglings and Mutalisks now rearing their ugly head. Those Widow Mines doing so much damage. They didn't even need the Marines to be there. So resources lost tab tells the story. 4,000 mineral, I guess I should say 4,000 resource discrepancy between these two players. And again, things are only going to get worse for Morgan Freeman. You may be saying, Sinvicta, how can you possibly consider Morgan Freeman behind at this point? Well, until the Ultralisk gets out, he's going to be very, very subject to an aggressive attack here, which is what Mr. Halloween is actually doing. He's going to be very, very exposed right now. Morgan Freeman desperately trying to get out 19 Banelings. And again, Mr. Halloween does possess most of the APM needed to micro around those. So here we go again, the flank coming in from the Ultralisk on the left side. And the Ultralisk storming on in, but running right into a siege tank. And those Marines are tearing up everything. The rock tower comes down. And I don't know exactly which one of the two players were attacking the rock tower. I almost want to say it was Morgan Freeman who attacked that rock tower, almost killed a couple Ultralisks of his. And again, this is what I was talking about. If Mr. Halloween goes after an exposed Morgan Freeman, his army is not unbeatable right now. This is not game one. He does more. Mr. Halloween, rather, has a much, much better unit composition here with even more siege tanks. He went more for a heavier Widow Mine play. And these Marines do have three attack. They're about to have three armor as well. Nice creep spread by Morgan Freeman. But outside of that, Mr. Halloween, this is his game to lose. Army supply tab once again in favor of Morgan Freeman. I'm sorry, of Mr. Halloween this time around. It's been in favor of Mr. Halloween. Zergling is just doing a little run by here. I think I don't know if that was a missed rally or not, but these Lings will at least be able to let everyone know where the army of Mr. Halloween is. And we are all kind of waiting anxiously to see what happens in this next engagement. I want to say that based on how many Ultralisks died and how little Marines died in that last engagement, that Morgan Freeman may have accidentally attack moved on the rock tower. It's only an assumption, though. So here we go again. Actually, the Marines are way out of position to deal with this. So are the Widow Mines. All the Widow Mine shots have been used, but now the siege tanks are getting the firing squad up, and they are blasting Ultralisks left and right. No siege tank died. Everything died of Morgan Freeman, and he is going to be in a lot of trouble. As Mr. Halloween, there's no reason for him to not press the matter at this point. These Widow Mines have been doing so much work on the army of Morgan Freeman, and they're about to do even more. The Ultralisk storming on in, taking out the Widow Mines, and they actually, a couple of them died to the Widow Mines and the Marines again. Two more Ultralisks still remain. Now one Ultralisk, that one Ultra, got thrown 50 yards behind the line. And GG is called, Mr. Halloween taking it. It's going to go to game three. That's exactly what I was talking about. You may have questioned, Sinvicta, how can you say that Mr. Halloween is behind in that, that Morgan Freeman is behind in that game? Well, you just saw the reason why. He's got way more Widow Mines this time around, and he did not have enough Ultralisks. He did not have the same amount of Ultras that hit in game number one as he did in game two, and that is certainly what cost him. So we are going to go to a final best of three, or the final game here in the final best of three. On Friday Night Fan Fights number 42, it's going to be TVZ. It's going to be on a map that I like. It's a fun map. It's kind of a pretty map, too, actually. An older map. It may not be the map that you're thinking of, though. It is not that map. It's not my favorite map of all time, but is a classic. Not as old as some of the other ones, but it's going to be good either way. We just make sure that the players are in the game. And we're about to begin the last game of the final best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 42, coming at you live here on September 19th, 2014. It's always awesome to see a tweet from Lethal Frag. I get fangirlish whenever I get to talk to Frag. I love Frag, man. He is an inspiration for everyone, and certainly a driving force of my inspiration here on Twitch. Here we are. Game number three, the final best of three, spawning on Yunsu, playing as the Blue Terran. He's a Diamond Leaguer, fought back beautifully too, ready to go and close out the series. Can he do it? He goes by the name of Mr. Halloween. And spawning on the northeastern side of Yeonsu, playing as the purple Zerg player. Also a Diamond Leaguer. He played beautifully in game one. A couple missteps in game two cost him. Can he turn it around and close the series out against his Terran opponent? Member of the Mosh Pit, he goes by the name of Morgana Freeman. Here we are. Yeonsu, a perfectly mirrored map. One of the better maps that's ever come out of StarCraft II, in my opinion. Some people don't like it. As a Zerg player, I personally like this map. Not only because of the huge ramp that goes into the natural expansion, but of course the ever-popular backdoor ramp that goes into the third base. It's also very, very easy to harass from behind, thanks to the two ramps that lead into the third base. Finery coming down and already saturated with SCV is going to be a standard opener for Mr. Halloween. Apparently, according to Hyena Bones, I'm a cutie fangirl, so there's that. Thank you, Hyena Bones. I'm glad I could be such a cutie fangirl for Lethal Frag. If I could name three people in the world that I would like to either sit down and have a beer with, or to just hang out with for a day. Let's see. I'd have a beer with James Rolfe, also known as the Angry Video Game Nerd, because he's a huge, not only is he obviously an icon in some respects of new media, but he's also a huge Godzilla Metallica fan. So I'd like to have a beer with James Rolfe. I'd like to hang out for the day with Lethal Frag. And I would like to. Who's the third person that I would hang out with? That I would like to hang out with. Apparently, Hyena Bones is only going to post weird things in chat now because that's all that I reply to, apparently. First blood is going to go to this Reaper here for Mr. Halloween. I would have a beer with James Rolfe, hang out for the day with Lethal Frag. And go to an event with my brother Tempo. There you go. Even though Tempo and I have been to many, many events together, I can never get old of my brother, my real life brother. Yeah, that should be a category. That should be a category. So, like, if you said co-optional podcast, who would you have a beer with, hang out with for a day, and go to an event with? Something like that. I think that should definitely be a new category instead of the Mary. What was it? It's kill, date, marry, or something like that. Whatever the stupid, whatever that stupid game is. It's like there's a category where it's like you have to kill one, marry one, and date the other. And yeah, that one's not nearly as fun. So Morgan Freeman, not going to be the victim of any harassment this time around, is dropping down a very, well, I guess it's not so, not that very early for third base. The SCV did, no, that's not a Marine in there. That is an SCV taking shelter in the bunker. As Morgan Freeman scouting out the natural expansion of Mr. Halloween. Here's a fun. Here's another fun random Sinvicta fact for you. I have an autographed photo from James Rolfe himself. It's very awesome. And I already. I mean, there's not a whole lot of people that I know that aren't already either subscribed to AVGN or at least know who he is. But that was like a staple of the early 2000s on the internet, back when the internet, or I guess new media wasn't so new. Everybody I knew who had internet was subscribed to AVGN, just because it was like, I mean, like if you had the internet and you cared about video games, you were always subscribed to Cinemassacre. But I really started to like James Rolfe whenever he started to do his, not only outside the AVGN stuff, when he started to do his Godzilla-thon, as well as he played the fun game, which is actually a game that I'd like to play on the channel one day. Not on YouTube, of course, because I'd get flagged copyright. But Name That Tune, he played it with Mike Matei, and they played Name That Tune Metallica. And if you don't know what Name That Tune is, or Guess That Tune, sometimes as it's called, you just take a song and play, like, literally a second and a half of it, and the person who is guessing has to guess it. Now the only advantage they have is that they know it's by the same band. It's only done by one band at a time, so like you'd have like Guess That Tune Metallica, Guess That Tune AC/DC, you know, whatever band that you want. And it was after the Name the Tune, Guess the Tune that James did with Mike with Metallica, and he actually did very well. He actually did probably better than I would have done. I was like, yeah, he's awesome. Angry Video Game Movie actually showed Cinemassacre actually did a preview, a very early screening of the AVGN movie in Houston, which I did not get to go see, but I really wanted to go see it. Wish I could have, that's for sure. So, a very interesting unit comp here. The Banshee is there to deal with extra damage on the Queens. And the Queens, unfortunately, are going to be... Well, one of the Queens was microed onto the army, but the other two Queens are now focused on the Banshee. Banshee's still alive. This is now a cloaked Banshee, and Morgan Freeman was totally not prepared for this. Army Supply Tab is going to be heavily in favor of Mr. Halloween. He may just end the game here. The drones trying to get away. They're lining them up for the Hellions. Hellions roasting and toasting drones. Oh, don't look. Just look away if you're a Zerg player. Down goes the third expansion. Morgan Freeman getting a little bit too greedy. And he was not expecting this at all. Centrifugal Hooks is going to land right in the nick of time. However, I don't think it's going to be enough for Morgan Freeman to deal with this. More Zerglings now streaming out of the main base, but there's only one queen, and that's that. Second queen actually just now arrived, but there's no detection. The evolution chamber, I'm not sure if I agree with Mr. Halloween going after the evolution chamber. Go after the spine crawlers, if anything, or take out the queens. Detection has now arrived, and the queens are going to begin assaulting the Banshees. Nice focus fire here on the Banshee that was already injured, and Morgan Freeman will be able to recover. But, man, oh, man, did he get punished going for this early fourth base. As this 300 minerals that he used, plus all the drones that he could have been using to either scout or shore up defenses, ends up being sunk and reestablishing his third base in a position that's undesirable, to say the least. So Mr. Halloween with a very nice attack. And Morgan Freeman luckily did not. That centrifugal hooks kicked in right in the nick of time. And he was able to muster a defense. That's the only way that he stayed in the game was those Banshee or those Marines getting taken out by those Banelings with the centrifugal hooks literally kicking in at the last second and taking out those Marines. So Morgan Freeman will indeed be able to stabilize, which is surprising. And again, I have to, I don't really want to second guess too much, but I would have definitely liked to have seen Mr. Halloween go after the Queens with the Banshee instead of going after the Evil Chamber. What does the Evolution Chamber get you? Nothing. It's not close to dying. You can see that it is researching something, but you know that you only have a limited time window in being able to take out something. If he takes out these two Queens, every single Ling that he has on the ground is dead until the Mutalisks came out, which at the time the Mutalisks were only just started production. But nothing we can do about it now, as we are going to see Morgan Freeman stabilize. He is now reestablishing his third base, technically his fourth base now. Mr. Halloween getting a scan on that. And now the flip side of things, if Mr. Halloween gets a little too complacent and lets Morgan Freeman recover enough, he will be in a lot of trouble, as he's only just now saturated the third base that he's had down here on the Southern Expansion, as Morgan Freeman will have been technically on three bases longer. Overlord, fortunately, is not going to be able to go to bowling tonight. And, oh, the Banelings rolling into the third base. Mr. Halloween, I can't even speak right now. That's like trying to tell someone they're about to get hit by a car. All the words come out at once and end up meaning nothing. Mr. Halloween had no idea about the Banelings because Morgan Freeman did not A-move them. And almost every single SCV just died. And if Morgan Freeman needed a way to slow down the advantage that Mr. Halloween had, that's one way to do it. So many SCVs just died at the third base, and Morgan Freeman, nice control there, not panicking, not overreacting with an A move on the Banelings. They stealthily snuck behind the Bioforce of Mr. Halloween. He had no idea because nothing was attacking, and the minimap did not tell him about it. So here we go again. Morgan Freeman moving out with Banelings and Queens. I don't really agree with him moving out. What is this Queen doing? That was a full energy Queen. I definitely don't agree with Morgan Freeman moving out with this force right now, as all these will be killed by Widow Mines. There's really no reason for him to do this. He needs to shore up defenses and reestablish his fourth, but he's going to go for it anyway. And the Zerglings and Banelings now crashing into the Bioforce of Mr. Halloween. He was waiting for the Widow Mine detonations to go off, which they did. And Morgan Freeman he lost the ground force. He may be able to come out ahead on this. But I feel that was a trade that was kind of unnecessary, because now he does not have enough units to stop the third base from going up. And he's throwing Mr. Halloween into panic mode, which is he's going to be building three more racks. Whereas he could have shored up defenses, could have gotten Burrow if he really wanted to. Actually, he does have Burrow. And all you got to do is just place some Banelings down here, place some Banelings over here, and also on this ramp over here, and you're completely fine. You take control of the entire northern hemisphere of this map. But instead, he threw away the Banelings and Zerglings for, honestly, not that much gain. He was able to kill a couple of Marines, but what does that matter at this point when you're going up against a three-basing Terran that has a ton of minerals? Widow Mines are going to get a shot off on the Overseer. About worst case scenario there for Mr. Halloween, because that did not kill the Overseer. And just like that, Mr. Halloween has back now with a ton of Marines. 2-2 almost complete. What are the upgrades for Morgan Freeman? He does have 2-2 on his ground forces, and these +2 Banelings are going to be so powerful. Even against +2 Terran Infantry Army, the Banelings will still get bonus damage on the Marines. Here we go, and you're about to see it in the flesh right now. So many Banelings crashing into the unseaged siege tank. The Marines trying to split their best. Look how many Banelings it took. Didn't take all that much. The siege tank goes down. Medevac goes down. Marines go down. And Mr. Halloween desperately trying to get out anything that he can to stop his third base from going down. Not going to happen. SCVs getting completely owned by just the Zerglings themselves. The third base is in flames right now as Mr. Halloween desperately trying to catch up. The command center will indeed follow these Marines. Nice little micro there, pulling the Zerglings and the Banelings back towards the Widow Mine, which eventually did die, but not before it did get a shot off. And Mr. Halloween forced into a corner now. And this is kind of what I was talking about. If he waited a little bit too long, Morgan Fremen is going to have four bases powering this force. And at that point, if you're going up against a Zerg player on more bases than you, he doesn't have to worry about value or trades anymore. That is what the Zerg is good for, swarming up and just crashing units left and right. Basically saying, my numbers are going to beat your numbers by way of attrition. We'll throw, if you've got 100 Marines, we'll throw 500 Zerglings at your face. We'll see which one runs out first. So the Baneling landmines there taking a couple of hits. Maybe three or four so Marines did die, but here comes the rest of the Banelings crashing into the Marine wall. Nice splitting there by Mr. Halloween. However, he does not have any siege tanks to deal with this. And the SCV is being pulled off the line. GG is called. Morgan Fremen takes the win, closes out the series. But it sure was scary. Mr. Halloween definitely had multiple times to win that game. But in the end, Morgan Fremen with a very, very nice defense. Thank you for watching, everyone. Hope you enjoyed it. For those of you watching here on Twitch, I'm going to run a block commercials and close out the show. For those of you watching on YouTube, thank you very much for watching. Don't forget that the 24-hour stream will be happening next Saturday, not this Saturday. It's going to be Saturday, the 27th of September. For those of you who stick around and watch the ads, do appreciate it. It does support myself as well as Twitch. And for those of you with Twitch TV Turbo and our ad block, you may not see any ads. But I will be closing out the show. See you all tomorrow for the Saturday Series Smackdown. It's the Binding of Isaac versus FTL. Can't wait. See you all tomorrow evening. Good night now.